Good morning.
Hello.
Hey, you've got to put that away during the session. Hi, I'm Tom.
Stan. Hi.
Yes.
Stan from Transparency International.
Excellent.
I'll be your portrait.
Excellent.
Well, not sure about that. Right?
Okay.
But it's been well.
Yep.
Very promising.
Yeah.
You'll be good.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Thank you.
No, I found pension. So far, I have already done a lot of memory and I need to go to the lunch table at the school to them and I
Hi, how are you?
Good.
I'm going to go to the next slide.
I Hey guys, picture. Easy bees. Easy bees.
Yes. Are we out? You should make a meal on my podcast.
I do, yes. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for attending this session. My name is John Hyde. I'm the chair of the Global Organization of Parliamentarians Against Corruption in Oceania, which is all of the Pacific and Australasia. I'm also on the national board, which is based in Ottawa, Canada. We've got a great panel here today for this session, and I know many of you in the audience too, and I know that you've got an interest in brand corruption. For those that are newcomers, I guess there are some forms of corruption that are so brave, with an effect on human life, human rights, and human welfare, which is so catastrophic that they should shock the conscience of the international community and mobilise the will of nations to act across borders. And this is what's become known as grand corruption. And it differs from ordinary corruption, both in the scale of its effects and the nature of its problems. Grand corruption not only breaks national laws, but still more seriously, it distorts and undermines the rule of law itself. Grand corruption is systemic, becoming an integrated and essential aspect of the very economic, social, and political systems that should be combating it. While many countries have established a legal framework to fight corruption, many struggle to enforce their laws in practice. Far too frequently, perpetrators are ignoring national judicial systems and shield themselves from the rule of law. As a result, the worst perpetrators of corruption can be the least likely to face justice. This session will facilitate a discussion to shape and to further concretize an international mechanism which should try those who are guilty of political corruption. So we're asking everybody here today, parliamentarians, and I know there's a lot in the audience here, from members of GOPAC, civil society members, citizens, and others, to design a solution to end impunity for corruption by creating an international mechanism, perhaps, that equates grand corruption with a crime against humanity. To get the conversation started, I'd like to present our speakers for this session. Each speaker will give a perspective to a conversation, and from there we'll then open discussion from the floor. And we have to be finished well and truly by 1 p.m, so I'll be crucial on time at the end. Now, our first speaker, Akaash, Maharaj, has been involved in advancing the public good throughout his professional and voluntary life. Over the past 3 years, he's been doing so as the Chief Executive Officer of the Global Organisation of Parliamentarians Against Corruption, and has worked with parliamentarians, civil society organisations in over 50 countries across the world to promote good governance and strengthen legislative oversight. He's worked extensively with legislators in the Middle East and Ukraine to develop politically nuanced and regionally sensitive anti-corruption programs, as well as to illustrate the impact of illicit financial flows, focus on prevention of asset outflows, and identify realistic targets for repatriation of these funds. He's raised the profile of political grand corruption on the global stage through active outreach with the media and civil society. He also advocates for greater outreach connections and communication with citizens at large, and has spoken at open government events in the United Kingdom, the US, and Latin America. Our second speaker, José Ugaz, is the Chair of Transparency International and a senior partner at the NITS, or known Ugaz law firm. He has a history of taking on grand corruption and has prosecuted several top-level corruption cases as Peru's ad hoc state attorney. Most notably, he was instrumental in the 2000-2002 corruption case against former Peruvian President Alberto Fujimori and Vladimiro Montesinos, the former head of the country's intelligence services. His office opened more than 200 cases against 1,500 members of the Fujimori network. Under his mandate, 205 US million in assets were frozen abroad and $150 million were recovered. He's been teaching criminal law in Peru since 1986. Our third speaker is Patrick Alley, the co-founder and director of Global Witness. Since posing as a timber buyer in Global Witness's first investigation into the Thai Khmer Rouge timber trade in 1995, Patrick has taken part in over 50 field investigations in Southeast Asia, Africa, and Europe, and subsequent advocacy activities. Patrick has focused on Global Witness's campaigns on conflict resources, notably former Liberian President Charles Taylor's arms for timber trade, the minerals trade in Eastern DRC, and more recently the Central African Republic, as well as providing strategic direction for Global Witness's work on forest issues, especially challenging industrial scale logging and land grabbing in the tropics. In addition, he's involved in the strategic leadership of Global Witness. So I'd now like to get the ball rolling by asking Akaash Maharaj for our opening address.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our session. Thank you for coming. As John said, I'm the CEO of Global Organization of Parliamentarians Against Corruption. We are a worldwide association of legislators who have come together across the world to combat corruption, strengthen democratic institutions, and uphold the rule of law. We have members in almost every country of the world. They come from different cultures, speak different languages, profess different faiths, pursue different political ideologies, and have been on, in some cases, on opposite sides of history and of warfare. But we are united by a single creed and a single idea, and that is we believe that corruption has now become the single greatest threat to human rights, to the welfare of societies, development and security of nations, and that if we as a people and as legislators, as civil society, cannot combat corruption, then almost everything else that we wish to achieve as human beings will fail. Now, anyone who works for an organization with the words parliamentarians against corruption, the type of, is accustomed to say, well, isn't that a contradiction in terms? And there's no denying that parliamentarians are just as human as everyone else and are just as apt to be part of the problem. But we believe that parliamentarians can and must be part of the solution, because absent parliamentarians playing that role, there is no one in the formal political process representing us, standing between our leaders and levers of power, overseeing and restraining their use of public resources and public power. Now, I'm not going to spend any time trying to persuade you that corruption is a bad thing. None of us would be here if we weren't already convinced of that. I do think, however, that even for us as members of the anti-corruption community, we can forget the scale of the issues that we are trying to combat. Just to give a sense of that scale, the UN Development Programme estimates that every year the world loses $1 trillion in bribes. The UNODC estimates that the world loses $2.1 trillion to illicit financial flows every year. The Tax Justice Network estimates that the world loses $3.1 trillion to tax evasion every year. These three methods alone fund $6.2 trillion. That is, to all intents and purposes, an incomprehensible amount of money. I think we can give some meaning to these figures by comparing them to the Millennium Development Goals. As we all know, the MDGs will next be achieved by 2015 this year, and they included ending starvation and extreme poverty, providing universal primary education, promoting gender equity in schools and workforce, reducing child mortality by 2/3, reducing maternal mortality by 3/4, halting the spread of HIV and malaria, promoting environmental sustainability, and halving the proportion of people without access to clean water and sanitation. And the United Nations estimates that we could have achieved all of those goals of $481 billion in overseas development aid. In other words, we could have achieved all of the MDGs and destroyed humanity's oldest enemies 12 times over what the world loses to corruption in a single year. To achieve any one of these goals would have been to change human civilization. To achieve all of them would have been to fundamentally transform the very notion of what it means to be a human being and to begin a new dispensation for our very species. And we could achieve all of them 12 times over. For what we could achieve all of them every 30 days for what we lose to corruption. There is, in a very real way, a world within our grasp, a world without hunger, without thirst, and without needless disease. And it is corruption that is keeping our world from us. Now, corruption is every level of society, and it must be fought at every level of society. But as Don said, we believe that grand corruption falls into a special category and deserves special attention and must be fought with special zeal. Because there are some forms of corruption that are so grave, whose effects on human life, human welfare, and human dignity are so catastrophic that they should mobilize the will of nations not to cross borders. Too often, the perpetrators of the worst forms of corruption are able to use their wealth and power to capture and subvert the very institutions which should call into account. And as a result of that, the great tragedy of law enforcement across the world is that the more corrupt you are, the less likely you are to face domestic justice. We believe, as an organization, that in such cases, the international community must step forward if domestic institutions are silent. At our most recent global conference, held in 2013, it was the single largest anti-corruption gathering of legislators in history. And they voted unanimously for our organization to seek to make grand corruption an international crime. We also called for international institutions and international alliances to apprehend, charge, try, and if convicted, sentence the guilty. And when I say unanimously, I mean unanimously. The legislators who voted for this resolution included legislators from Russia and Ukraine, from India and Pakistan, from Iran and Iraq, from Sudan and South Sudan. People who have come from countries that agree on absolutely nothing else, nevertheless agree on this. And I think for those of us who face daily the statement that this cannot be done, that level of unanimity, I think, displays the extent to which we understand this must be done. We are pursuing implementation of this resolution by four separate tracks. The first is the use of universal jurisdiction. The idea behind universal jurisdiction is that there are some crimes so egregious that it becomes not just the right, but the responsibility of every country to try its perpetrators, irrespective of the nationality of those perpetrators, and irrespective of where those crimes were committed. The obvious precedent is the war crimes legislation, and since the Nuremberg trials at the end of the Second World War, there has been settled international law, and it is in part of international norms, that universal jurisdiction is both legal and appropriate in case of the worst crimes. We feel that, as legislators, this is our first port of call because our members can pass domestic legislation and it can give domestic courts in some countries the ability to reach out and bring to justice perpetrators of grand corruption in other countries where those perpetrators have suffocated institutions in their own jurisdiction. Having said this, we recognize that there are inherent weaknesses in universal jurisdiction. Of the 78 countries who have passed anti-war crimes legislation, only 15 have ever made any attempt to implement them, and often universal jurisdictions reach and exceed those grounds. A key example is with the case of Pinochet, who was charged by Spanish court to sought extradition from the United Kingdom for crimes against humanity he had committed in Chile. The UK courts and political process decided that Pinochet was too sick to pay the penalty, although he was enormously sick to fly back to Chile and have an enormous party celebrating his ability to slip through the fingers of justice. The second factor we are pursuing, less miraculously, is our regional courts. There are regional courts in Africa, Europe, and the New World, and they are often more credible than global institutions because they are less likely to be accused of public imperialism or regional irrelevance. There's also a precedent for regional courts expanding their jurisdiction to try cases of grand corruption, the most famous one. Is the 2010 case of the socioeconomic rights and accountability group that brought charges of grand corruption against the state of Nigeria. The court, the economic community of West African states, community court of justice, agreed to hear the case and agreed to do so in defiance of the member state Nigeria on the grounds that grand corruption is an affront to human rights and human dignity. We have members working in America and other parts of the world specifically on trying to create and empower regional courts. Once again, there are weaknesses to the regional court approach as well. In the case of the COAS, some 60% of the judgments go unenforced. Regional courts are often their credibility bounce against that is a lack of power. The third strategy we are pursuing is the use of similar civil remedies. And we are pursuing specifically in New York State in the United States. For any of my colleagues in the room who are American, I say that at least amongst my American friends, the only thing that they love more than their country is the prospect of suing people. And the idea behind civil action is that if we cannot take the facts in custody, then we need to leave them deprived of their illicit gains in an attempt to reduce them and, if possible, reduce them to poverty. We are in the process of working with the VAT Center and the New York Bar Association to identify what we're calling exemplary practitioners. People who are so odious that they will excite no sympathy from anyone in the world, who have assets in New York, specifically in Manhattan real estate, and whom we feel we have a credible chance of using enough evidence to bring them to at least deprive them of their American assets. It's important, of course, that the first person we choose is someone we can actually get. But we hope in this case that we will have a case ready for his consideration by our board by the middle of 2016. Once again, there are weaknesses with the approach of civil remedy. No amount of money is ever going to truly pay for the crimes of the crimes. Secondly, 98% of the lawsuits in New York State never go to court. They end in settlements. And I can only say myself personally, I am troubled by the ethics of settlement in that. The fourth and final stream that we are pursuing is the use of creation of new international instruments. Some of these are, especially with judges in the United States, around the creation of a new international anti-corruption court created specifically to try crimes of grand corruption. Others are the creation of an optional protocol of the UN Convention Against Corruption to allow states to subscribe to it, to have a process for extradition and mutual recognition and mutual assistance in criminal prosecutions that would mirror mutual assistance in forfeiture or in the China stolen assets. Once again, there are challenges here. The International Criminal Court is a good example of the challenges that all international institutions face. As a court, it has been going for 12 years, it has secured two convictions. The challenges are enormous, resources are thin, and to be perfectly frank, while everyone in the world can imagine someone else committing acts of crimes against humanity or war crimes, most political actors can imagine themselves committing an economic crime, and they are therefore potentially less likely to be enthusiastic about such institutions. Needless to say, each of our approaches has different strengths and different weaknesses, each of them strikes a different balance between the idea and the often feasible. And as a result, we recognize that the journey will be long and the path will be hard, and that all of us will be beset by people who have grown power from the front of the status quo. But we really do believe this is the call of our time. And we have an obligation as a people to say that we will not be put off by the difficulties. Because as hard as it would be to achieve these goals, the consequences of not achieving them are too terrible to contemplate. This is the mandate of history. And we feel that all of us, legislators, civil society, individual citizens, have a responsibility to be equal to that mandate. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Akaash. Really interesting points in there. I'm sure we'll draw some comments and questions later on. I'd now like to hand to our second speaker, José Ugaz, the Chair of Transparency International.
Thank you, John. The issue of grant corruption is a very relevant and exciting one for Transparency International. We've been observing in the past years that what John called ordinary corruption was a typical situation of widespread administrative corruption, and in some cases, some political leaders taking money to their states. And from time to time, one big case appeared. We can list them now: Abacha in Nigeria, Marcos in the Philippines, Suharto in Indonesia. But they were not a typical case. But in the past years, we've been observing that now the typical cases of corruption are all huge, involving criminal networks, organizations, and mobilizing billions of dollars, and having, of course, impact in the situation of the countries where this happened, usually third world countries with extended parts of population in extreme poverty. So we started wondering in TI, what was happening regarding corruption. And we opened a debate 5 years ago in an annual membership meeting. We started to debate on this issue. And someone proposed from the assembly that we should try to take some of these big cases to the International Criminal Court. But that debate didn't go for long because our lawyers that were present there, member lawyers I mean, said that it was impossible. That corruption was not part of that customary law, you know, some technicalities regarding what cases you can take to such a court. So the attempt of passing a resolution on this failed, and we established a commission that started inquiring what possibilities we had of addressing these issues of corruption and take them to this court or some other instance in the international level or trying law jurisdiction, as Akaash just mentioned. And it took us like 4 years to arrive to a conclusion that we were not really advancing on the thing, so we decided to retain a consultant, and we went deeply on the issue. And the conclusions of this report was that it was difficult to take corruption cases to International Criminal Court, even though apartheid is not a crime that derived from customary law, and it was admitted in the Statute of Rome. It was not feasible that the court will admit cases of grand corruption as part of the award. So then we jumped into global jurisdiction, we looked into the Pinochet case, and the conclusion was that it wasn't even a fast track that we could find through this time. So what we decided was to start a study that will begin with, first of all, understanding what we're talking about when we talk about grant corruption. So there was an issue of definition. And we've been working on this definition. We will launch it in the next problem. We had a workshop in New York in February this year where we put together more than 20 experts in legal issues and activists in anti-corruption. And we started working on the definition. So now we have almost a definition for the laypers and a legal definition that is not intended to be a statute, a legal statute for the countries, but it would be a follow-up tool for advocacy on legal issues for those countries that are willing, that have a political will to put in their, incorporate to their legal systems this issue of corruption. And this is because nowadays, what some years ago was like extraordinary having from time to time one of these big cases as the ones I mentioned. Now we find them daily on the newspaper. The China leaks revealed that more than 300 Chinese high-level members of the party and public officials had personal accounts in the Bahamas with millions of dollars. The Global Witness has done a great work and a report on the Obiang family in Equatorial Guinea, and we can see the millions of dollars that these people are losing from Equatorial Guinea. Yanukovych, he ran away and now the accounts are still going up, but more or less we're talking about at least $300 million that have been taken by this guy. We've seen all the scandals regarding the banks, HSBC, PNBC, Paribas, Commerce Bank. We're talking about billions of dollars. In the case of HSBC, we're talking about at least $40 billion that have gone to the drug cartels of Mexico. And in the case of PNB Paribas, money going to terrorist groups. So we're talking about also laundering money for organized crime and terrorism. This is quite serious. Now, the scandal of Petrobras in Brazil, we are talking about at least $2.5 billion that have been taken from this oil company, and the big construction companies of Brazil, and the 10 biggest companies of the region, are involved in this scheme of corruption. Martinelli in Panama, it has fled to Miami, and the accounts are around $2.5 billion that have been taken from the Panamanian state. Of course, we just talked about this yesterday, Malaysia, this country, the prime minister with $700 million in personal account that he cannot escape. And if we go to the fund where this money probably has come, we're talking about $6.6 billion that are under suspicion of being a target for corrupt practices. And we can continue with this because it's enormous. What I'm trying to say is, what we call ordinary corruption is a different animal than this one. This is totally different. So the definition we are working on at this point has basically three elements. When we talk about grand corruption, we are talking about actors of high level in power. And we are talking about economical power. This could be related to private actors, like the CEOs of the Brazilian company, for example, or high level in power on politics, politicians, people that have power in the public service. Second, we are talking about big amounts involved in these structures of corruption. And we had some legal problems with, you know, theoretical problems where we were discussing the legal definition. How can we amount, which is the limit to start talking about grand corruption and regular corruption? So we start there. We have some formulas. In one case, it's a big number. More than 2,500 ordinary minimum salaries of the country, a percentage of the GDP. There are several ways of trying to reach this. Of course, it always would be arbitrary, but the idea is to target relevant cases where big amounts are involved, and no, not those that we can consider ordinary. And the third element, and very relevant for us, is the impact of drug corruption on humans. And there's no doubt at this point, particularly in countries from the south, that grand corruption is having a huge impact in fundamental rights. We're talking about education, people that die, the Ebola case in Sierra Leone. Money from the Ebola fund was stolen by the government of the Sierra Leone. And this has direct impact on the life of people. More than 6,000 people have died from Ebola in Sierra Leone. And the money of that fund has been stolen. So the impact on human rights would be the third element that we consider is relevant to this definition. So now that we almost have these two definitions, we are moving into our next stage of the strategy. And this will be to try to make advocacy. It is true that it will be very difficult, I will not say impossible, to take grand corruption cases to the International Criminal Court. But that doesn't impede that we can go to the court and talk to the prosecutor, because if you see the cases that are being tried before the ICC, all of them, most of them, more than 90%, I would say, involve issues of crime corruption. They are talking about crimes against humanity, but most of the people that are now sitting on the bench of the investigation conducted by the court have a component of corruption. So we can convince a prosecutor of the ICC to consider grand corruption not as a crime to be tried before the court, but as a criteria of admissibility of a case. And I think that would be a good advantage if the court could say, okay, these people are going to be tried because crimes against humanity, but there is also a component of corruption. And this should be considered as a criteria for admission of the case. And secondly, we believe that it's possible that a court start considering grand corruption as an aggravating factor of a crime against humanity. So we are not intending to put a case and be tried as a grand corruption case, but if there is a component of grand corruption in a crime against humanity, we believe that it could be considered as a factor to say, instead of putting this guy 10 years in prison, we'll put him 12. Because there's an issue of grand corruption that is having impact in human. So the ICC is one way we want to go and make advocacy decision. Secondly, the human rights system. Since grand corruption is having impact in human rights, we can go to the United Nations system and try that system to see if we can incorporate grand corruption on the way human rights abuses are treated. Recently, United Nations, in the report on Venezuela on human rights, has listed corruption as one of the violations of human rights that are happening in Venezuela. And this is a great advantage. For the first time, United Nations is recognizing that corruption has an impact in human rights. So this opens a window for us to try to work on the system in UN or go to the regional courts, like the American court, the African court, and see if we can obtain some relevant impact on those people. And thirdly, now that we have our allies here, parliamentarians concerned about corruption, we have this draft of legal ruling on grand corruption. And if someone is willing to pass a law in their country in order to incorporate the criminal code a crime of grand corruption, of course we will be happy to discuss with them and provide them the work we've been doing on this issue. So there are different avenues we can explore. Now, we've been talking to Judge Wolf. Some of you have heard about him. Judge Wolf is a judge of Boston, United States, that is advocating for an international court against corruption. So a new international body that will try these cases of corruption. That's a difficult one. Because if we see the history, in order to have an ICC, many countries were very reluctant to have even a court for cases against humanity. You can imagine governments voting for a court that at the end could be tried in them because they are involved in corrupt practices. So there's a big political challenge there. We are, of course, supporting Judge Wolf's effort, but we prefer for now to go in these different strategies and try to do something in the short term. Finally, we are also going to try some cases. Casey Kelso here is our officer in charge of this. He had collected 32 cases of grand corruption that have been brought to our attention from our chapters. We have gone through those cases. Finally, we shortlisted some of them, and now we have one. And yesterday, we had a meeting with the people of our national chapter of that single case. I will not name it just to keep tension on this. Probably in a short term, you will be hearing that Transparency International is going to get involved in a legal case of a grand corruption situation in one country or a chapter is working. So we are defining the strategy and how we want to go forward.
Thanks very much for that, Jose. A lot of great ideas coming out there that I think a number of people here will Lynch on that, particularly that issue of the definition. I wrote some view with my colleagues from UNODC and UNDP when we're going into new democracies, particularly in the Pacific, first thing parliamentarians and others are asking is, like, what's the definition of corruption? And even within the UNCSC, the Act, we don't have an agreed definition. So to be having progress in terms of the definition of grand corruption, I know we've got some of the people here involved in anti-corruption standing committees in parliaments in the Pacific. That is going to be a real help for them. It's a great step forward. I think we'll come back to that as well. Now we'd like to come to our third speaker, not our final speaker, because there's so many more out here. Patrick Elliott.
Thank you. I actually think the reason Transparency International is not so keen on the course idea is because the court we call the International Anti-Corruption Court, the IACC, which I think would be a sort of conflict. Forgive me if you're all better read than I, but I came across a quote the other day from a French philosopher from the early 19th century, Frederick Bastiat. And I think it alludes to what we would have as kind of a wider definition of corruption, which fits in with what José is saying, which is when plunder becomes a way of life for a group of men in society over the course of time, they create for themselves a legal system that authorizes it and moral code that glorifies it. And one of the things that Bella Witness is working on is what we call the shadow system. The system that, to all intents and purposes, looks legal, but actually you take it apart and it's a thing that involves corruption. In my sense, you know, Global Witness has often been accused in its campaigns by various governments of trying to achieve regime change. It's almost always isn't true. But sadly, experience tells us that regime change is one currently the best prerequisites to getting action on corruption, because the entrenched corrupt regimes are obviously not going to do anything, which argues for some kind of greater mechanism. I just wanted to touch on a couple of cases that are going, well, they may go forward. And I think I'm going to talk about them to illustrate the hurdles that are in the way of things that shouldn't be so difficult. And I'm hastening to add, I'm not a lawyer, so forgive me. And we support choice in cases we can talk about. One is very relevant to what José was saying just now, relating to the ICC. I'll come to that second. The first one is in Nigeria. For some years now, we've been working with some of our partners, Corner House, Recommon, and Nigerian activists, those in Europe, looking at what happened to the payments of $1.1 billion, which is two-thirds of the 2014 health budget for Nigeria. That the oil companies Shell and the Italian state oil company pay for the rights to one of the richest offshore oil blocks in Nigeria, PL245. The money was paid to the Nigerian government. The Nigerian government paid exactly the same amount of money to a company owned by a former oil minister and also convicted money launderers. This guy, Dan Atete, is a minister under a Thatcher, and he awarded the block to a company called Malibu Oil and Gas, which he conveniently and secretly, along with the then President Summer and the Bachelor, amongst others. Shell and Eni thus far, and we've been plugging away at this for a few years, has said we paid the money to the Nigerian government, so it's legitimate. We had evidence, including email communications, which showed that they were negotiating with Eni and Malibu Oil and Gas a long time. And if we're right on this, that means that the Nigerian government was simply a straw man, as a conduit to get the money that was mounted. The case is currently being investigated by the Italian public prosecutor, and it's also being investigated by the Nigerian Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, who were less enthusiastic under the old Attorney General, who's the guy who actually broke the deal in the first place. But under the new government, become more enthusiastic. It's also being investigated by the UK's National Crime Agency, amongst others. The Italian prosecutor considers that the payments are potential bribes, and also that any officials and associates who are trying to bring off $200 million of the $1.1 billion kickbacks. Currently, and at the prosecutor's request, $190 million is frozen in the UK and in Switzerland, which is money belonging to Malibu and a middleman. It's thought to be a conduit for kickbacks. It's interesting, we really tried very hard to get the UK to prison money in the ICC. This is a case that would be ideal for some kind of international court, some kind of international mechanism. It could be tried in the US, the UK, Italy, or the Netherlands. Currently, we think it would be better tried in Nigeria, because otherwise, it's a shell in any kind of jurisdiction shop, which could be a real nightmare. The remedies we'd be looking for in this would be revocation of the deal, revocation of the block, corporate accountability for Shell and Eni, and that would be exacerbated because when they started brokering this deal in 2011, they were both subject to deferred prosecution agreements in the US for other corruption cases in Nigeria, one of which was involving some of these people. Criminal accountability, of course, is needed for various individuals, both within companies and public officials. And the current and former CEOs of Eni are currently being investigated as charges. And of course, the middlemen, the enablers, need to be the step two, including banks like JP Morgan, who transferred the $1.1 billion. Under the old regime, this case could have gone nowhere in Nigeria. But there is definitely a will we're seeing to take this somewhere. As I said, the Attorney General in the old regime sprinkled holy water on the program. But now the country can identify itself as a victim. And it would be an important illustration. One of the criticisms of the ICC, of course, is that the African leaders would say, well, this is the way it's targeting us. Here you've got certainly officials in Nigeria, but you have some of the biggest Western companies that there are. And then you have to be in train and banks, of course. It's interesting, just as a side point, so the only reason we heard about this case was because there was a row between Tete and one of the fixers of the deal. And it went to arbitration in New York first and then to London. And some documents started coming out. Otherwise, we wouldn't have known. An interesting point again, the English judge in this case ruled on that arbitration and divided up the spoils, which we liken to a master criminal mediating between a master criminal and a bank robber. And there's no consideration that the whole thing is just illegal. It's also worth noting, I'm being accused of here for a plug, that it's this kind of secrecy that makes Section 1504 of the Dodd-Frank Act in the US and the EU Transparency Directive so crucial, because they require project by project disclosure by these companies. So that's one case. The next one, going back to what Jose was saying, relates to a land rights case in Cambodia. This has nothing to do with global, and this is our case in flat, but we're very, very supportive of it. Complaint has been filed at the International Criminal Court on behalf of 10 Cambodian victims whose identity has been protected for fear of retribution. The law firm called Global Diligence LLP alleges that the country's ruling elite and the senior members of the government, the military, and business leaders have waged a widespread and systematic attack on Cambodian civilians, and I quote, motivated by self-enrichment and maintaining power at all costs. The case concerns land grabbing. The most recent submission states that 830,000 people in Cambodia have been affected by land grabbing, 5.5% of the population. And although the case doesn't focus on corruption, actually clearly the corruption, self-enrichment, as the case calls it, is both the driver and the facilitator of serious and widespread human rights. And straight forward, as it said. The case focuses on the regime's policy of land grabbing. Following land grabbing conducted in Cambodia on a truly massive scale, and crimes that accompany this amount to a crime against humanity. It should be punishable under international law. And it looks at this through two lenses. The first is self-enrichment by the ruling elite. obtaining an economic land concession can be hugely profitable for businesses in that sector. And having worked in Cambodia for many, many years, we would suspect it's highly likely that government officials have asked for bribes and kickbacks, and also that the company would not only have paid them, but would also possibly have paid the army and police to help evict people from their land. Also, the tycoons further entrenched their position at the top of the tree, and the situation goes on. The second lens is maintaining power at all costs. So, the case outlines that the voting leaders want to campaign of land seizures characterized by murder, penal imprisonment, and persecution. As I said, 830,000 people have been affected since 2000, 20,000 new victims in the first 3 months. 2014 alone. And indeed, one of our own colleagues used to work with us, with a land right activist in Cambodia, was murdered by police in 2012. So the complaint is currently with the Office of the Prosecutor, the OTP, the ICC, and the victims are waiting to hear if the OTP will open a preliminary investigation, which means that we have a good basis to explore the allegations. I'm not sure anyone is terribly optimistic about this, but that is the avenue that they're trying to do. I think I'll stop there. I could go on case after case, but that's all right.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, we've had three distinct perspectives being on screen corruption, an issue of bringing the perpetrators to justice. I'm certainly very interested in Jose's track record in Peru in recovering those assets and the actual money. The issue that Akaash has raised about being able to spend what we've lost in corruption and achieving the Millennium Development Goals. When I was a member of parliament and we passed legislation on proceeds of crime, and we were getting $60 million a year back from drug dealers, extortionists, and others. And it was really into the mindset of government is that money that comes back in, that proceeds, just send it to Treasury. The treasurers and governments often want it there. What we did as parliamentarians was to write in the legislation that 50% of the proceeds had to go to victims of crime. So it's one issue in terms of grand corruption in going after the perpetrators, getting the money back, but then what happens with the money. And I'd really be interested in your perspective in terms of the money that came back in Peru, where it went, how was it used, and is that a transparent process as well? I might just throw that as the first question, and then I'll start taking in a gender parity way and you parity way, as well as some questions from the board. Jose. Okay, all right, we're democratic, that's good. All right, let's have some more questions from the board. From the floor. But one of the rules is the person who suggests the changing of the rules doesn't benefit immediately. General, first one. You can be second, then all right.
My name is Simon. I'm a journalist with the Nikkei Review. It's a question for José. Did you receive any feedback or follow up from the emerging government after your speech yesterday?
Okay, great question. Number two.
I am looking from very transparency. Well, concerning the project, yes. I didn't know that my interventions in many conferences in Brazil, in Panama, so because this was my point of view, is that there should be amendment in the ICC to make serious corrupt people that should be brought before justice. To address as they are so influential in their countries, and sometimes they are the rulers of their country, so you cannot have scrutiny in their own country. So, what do you think about the prospect to, and then Roma statute to such as to emulate, let's say, corrupt, serious corrupt. Second, I want to make a very good comment about Hyde. About Hyde, which is part of the law. It's made of one set that's Muslims who represent very good. And they are also complacent in corruption. As you see, they don't have, and they have given. They don't have
problems. Okay, thank you. Number three.
Thank you very much. My name is Cynthia from the Center to Combat Corruption and Cronyism in Malaysia. We've got some very compelling arguments about how corruption breeds impunity and how it leads to rights and so on. But my question is about the lack of legal instruments in actually taking perpetrators to court, whether it's the ICC or any. One example is Malaysia, the Chief Minister of Sarawak, Hyde Mahmud. We all know that his case is a very clear case of grand corruption. He's got more than 400 companies around the world in the name of his family members. There are just about the same number of cases and files opened by the IACC, but he has not had a single charge placed against him so far. So local witness has been chasing him. I mean, many, many groups have been talking about this corruption, but he has not been able to be charged. What we have, it's like the Swiss government opening an ordering case against him. But that's very bilateral. It's because he has a bank account there, or he has a bank account in Singapore, or he has a bank account in some other country. But there has been no real way in which we could challenge grand corruption to that extent. So now we're looking at another example of one MDB, in which money has been parked in offshore islands and so on and so forth. So my second question is the link between grand corruption and money laundering, and whether that would be an easier way, not easier, but a more tangible way of actually bringing perpetrators to justice. How can we link these arguments to show that corruption actually kills? And so that's why the argument to bring it to ICC or any other court would be more compelling now, given the increasing number of cases. So where is the legal recourse internationally to actually bring these perpetrators to justice? Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Number four. And then we'll keep going around the clock. Roshan Tendros from Monitoring Evolution from the Afghans. My question goes actually to José, bringing some of the grand corruption cases. So I think it's very very promising because we have been facing sometimes cases that we were unable to deal with nationally, and I think we needed some international alliances to bring those cases forward. As one of the examples I can mention, that at one point a lot of ministers. His account was found to be transferred to millions of dollars, and he was a Christian who recently escaped from that. And the reason is that he is very highly supported. He financed the presidential campaign of the previous president, and the current president. And it's very, very difficult actually to kill his head, especially by the government. And we know that he also collected like over couple of hundred million dollar assets in Canada, and it's very, very difficult still to go through the investigation, detection, and everything which is needed. So my question basically is that what would be the criteria or the mechanism that if someone can refer a case to TI, because I know that you just mentioned that some of the TI chapters from other countries, they work on some special cases and it was transferred. Since in Afghanistan you don't have a TI chapter, and I know that I think it's in the process of maybe establishing an office soon, but it would be the case that others can also refer the cases. And if that's the case, then we would be interested to work on some of those.
Okay, thank you. From
5 and 6.
Yeah, my name is Dave Mirabella. I'm a journalist and journalism trainer. The example, my question that comes to mind would be Myanmar, where I'm curious the panel thinks to be argument. Some people make the argument that if you bring the perpetrators of grand corruption there, it's justice. So they ever felt threatened that would happen. So many of them are still in power there that if they felt threatened, they would put the brakes on the reform process they're going through right now.
If that's a big issue in our region here. And the final question in this session now.
My name is Stina Werner. I'm from the National Development Center of the Republic of Moldova. Actually, I'm thank you for this very interesting presentation. And I'm really glad to create this discussion, exciting discussion about human rights. I'd like to raise 2 points in this regard that I think also a worthwhile considering. First, that human rights are being affected not only in grand corruption cases. Human rights are affected in potentially any case of ordinary case of corruption as well. Because one person's favor as a result of bribe is equal to another person being denied a right. Even without this person wanted to be denied a right. So usually corruption opens very widely to the door to discrimination and true discrimination to denial of the person's right, basically the entire loss of human rights through the discrimination that takes place. Of course, the higher the corruption, the more human rights are being violated as well. Second thing that I want to raise is that the human rights argument is very much exploited by legal officers. And not only to avoid liability by themselves in cases of corruption, but also they using human rights arguments very often in order to prevent inventing of efficient anti-corruption tools. Because any of the anti-corruption tools somehow are biting a little bit from the human rights to the use of corruption. So is the case with regulating the illicit engagement, where you do presume some certain activity that you cannot hire the proof. So you do buy it from the presumption of innocence, like you do buy it from the right to property of those. Because you can, it's not possible simply to put every single act of corruption that is taking place in order to get to this final enrichment of the public official. If you see somebody who is not able to provide arguments and the property that is out there, and you can, it's impossible to request from the prosecution to put every single corruption act that stayed behind this enrichment. So this and the same goes true for standard confiscation tools, introducing this law clause protection because this is somehow denying the right, some rights related to fair trial and the right to be confronted to the person who is making arguments against you. And then when we are speaking about people who are so powerful as powerful politicians or oligarchs, then it is somehow justified to have a larger intrusion into the human rights area as compared to the ordinary citizens who cannot afford such protection. In Moldova, when we take something who is more important, for instance, we have somebody who is taken to court for trade union claims to work on $1 million to determine him to leave a political faction and for another one, you know, to disrupt certain political processes in the country. This person found the tabloids in court every time. So, it's the anti-corruption agency is simply harassed by armies, literally armies of employees, best with in the country. So, and they all claim so much the human rights of their defendants. So, I am even very much considering that in the National Anti-Corruption Agency, we are trying to develop tools about related to integrity, fighting corruption. Which are aimed at pointing out at all time what are the stakes for the human rights of each and of corruption in order to simply to remind to the public that it is not only the corrupt who have human rights, they actually violate even more important human rights of the people, that they are paid from their money in order to watch for their rights and not to protect their own human rights. So my question would be, would it be possible at some point, of course we have the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, we have the European Convention of Human Rights, but the jurisprudence is something that not everybody is able to follow. And believe me, the armies of lawyers from big around are more able to exploit this very diverse jurisprudence to their own favor. And the ordinary people whose rights are being violated by the grand corrupt, they don't have such possibility to hire so many lawyers and to look into all these details. Maybe it is better to have someone articulated what would be the normal way of intrusion into the right to privacy, into the right to fair trial, into the right to presumption of innocence, right to property, or to be public official discussion on the speaker available. So that it is very clear cut to everybody that this is not something you can claim as a consensus.
Thanks very much for those six comments and questions interspersed there. I'll throw back to the panelists. We'll start in reverse order, so I'll just ask Patrick first of all just to comment on issues that were relevant to you or direct questions that were to any of the other speakers. So, Patrick, we'll start with you.
Thank you. I'm not my first now. Yeah, the question on Taib Mahmoud is one very close to our hearts as local witness. It's remarkable that this criminal has got away with it for so long. Without giving too much away, I'm doing the plenary at 2 o'clock, and I'm focusing on exactly that, and I'm going to ask the YouTube minister who was going to do that. Say, I don't know, we're not meeting with him after, so should be cancelled as a result of that. We shall see. But I think that, as TI announced yesterday, this competition unmasked the corrupt. I think he's a worthy candidate. Sarawak is a world-class example of a kleptocratic state. On Afghanistan, I know the question there was directed to José. We worked on Afghanistan over the years. I think it's a really interesting point because the transition with the international coalition moving away from Afghanistan is predicated on two major things. One of which is that the Afghan government in regard to their own security, and secondly, the country is incredibly resource-rich in minerals and therefore would be well off. We all know what happens in corrupt countries that are resource-rich unless something is done about it. And the coalition had a task force to look at corruption, but they refused to touch President Karzai because they knew he was the problem. So unfinished business. I can't resume to Myanmar. My colleague Megan over there might want to, an expert on the subject. And finally, I think the colleague from Moldova to various points. The thing I'm about with that, because a lot of those are unanswerable unless we all get it right. If we want the outgunned, we want the outnumbered, if we're outlawed, outfinanced. But I think that there needs to be a much wider education on what corruption actually is. I think too many people think it's a victimless crime, and too many people think it's only paying some money around under the table, as opposed to the oil lobbyists. Could be widely mentioned in the country yesterday, to the revolving door in government, to the lawyers, the company service providers, the accountants, the banks that make it all possible. They're all involved in corruption.
Thank you.
On what happened with the money that was recovered by the Canadian government from Fujimori, there was a big debate of what to do with that money. The money should get into the regular budget or some special treatment should be put in place for that, for those assets. There was a huge risk, and it had happened in many places. The money that is recovered from corruption then goes again to corruption.
And that's a terrible situation. So we were really concerned about this. We call those that call this money integrity funds because they have been recovered from corruption. And we wanted to assure that those funds keep in. So what we convinced the government to do is to create a fund that's called Pelador with a clear ruling on the possible destination of those funds. The first one was investment in the anti-corruption system. The second one was for reparation of victims of human rights. As you may know, Peru went through a very difficult, violent process with two terrorist groups in Bath and Tupac Amaru. There were many victims that have been recognized by the state. And the idea was that that money should go for the reparation of those victims. And three other issues additional to these two. And it worked very well at the beginning. But then, you know, when there's money in a poor state or a middle income state, everybody's trying to put this hands on. And the Ministry of Justice made an amendment to the ruling and then included some other things. And part of the money went for an increase of the salary of the public officials and the Ministry of Justice. So, but I think funds are a good way to assure that this money will not return to the corrupt hands. And in the case group, the World Bank has been looking at this type of situations. And they have the recovery asset initiative, and there are some ideas that can be going to come. But in our case, that was the experience, and that's how it was handled. We didn't have any feedback from Malaysia, from the Malaysian government until yesterday. I saw only one news local newspaper today, and they say anything about the intervention we did. Speech. So, excuse me.
Well,
they
want to
from the Statute of Rome, amending the Statute of Rome from the inquiry we've done at this stage of the situation is practically impossible. There's no political to remove that statute, so that's one of the reasons we decided not to insist in trying to add grand corruption as one additional crime to be treated in the court. But we do believe that it's feasible from a prosecutor of the court, as I mentioned before, including grand corruption as a factor that should be considered. And we have heard there are several cases before that court that have a significant component of corruption, and that should be addressed in the ruling of the court. So we will see what happens. We are just thinking of starting this process to work. It is obvious that grand corruption situations always have need of a money laundering scheme. Nobody steals money to put it under their debt. So money laundering is hand to hand one of the elements that is always present in cases of grand corruption. But it's not easy to trace money, and it's not easy to recover money, because now in this global world with all the financial and technical resources, it's very difficult to, first of all, track the money, and then once you have found it, link it to the corrupt author, and then try to recover it. It's a very complex process. That's why we in Transparency International now are advocating for this global registry on anonymous offshore companies, in order to know who are the ultimate beneficiaries of these companies. A report that was released by the OECD on the last December, they made an investigation of 450 cases of state parties of the OECD, 450 cases of corruption, and most of them, offshore companies were the vehicles through which the money was taken from the state papers. So, trying to lift the bill of the offshore companies and then bring technical experts, because and we confronted this in the Peruvian case. We needed people with financial background in order to try to understand all these complex schemes on how the money is taken out of the country. So It's a difficult one, but it's absolutely indispensable. So that's why organizations like ours need to or build technical expertise or bring others, and partnering is always a good idea in order to obtain those resources. In the case of Afghanistan, we are in conversation with the government. The current president has called PI, and we have set a couple of officials that are trying to define if something is feasible in the current situation. But of course, if you have a case, we will be happy to look at it. Casey Kelso is there, is our cases guy. So you can talk to him. Finally, on your comment on corruption and immense amount of resources of the corrupt actors, it is true. I just received a comment coming to this session that Martinelli, the former president of Panama, has 14 lawyers working with him right now in order to prepare his defense. And he already has proactively approached some organizations, and our chapter said, be careful. We are observing what you're going to say, what you're going to do. So, you know, they started already all these legal threats in order to stop inquiries on this case. So I do believe that campaigning in this case is very relevant. What you say, I fully agree. We need to send a message and to link corruption to the real concrete consequences of corruption for the victims. One of the problems is that corruption, the victims of corruption are not always aware that they are victims. I mentioned in a meeting at UNDP 2 days ago that I was observing a report on TV in my country, and a very poor woman was approached by the journalist, and she was asked what did he think about the situation that 55% of the Peruvian in a survey declared that they were willing to vote for someone they knew was corrupt, that they thought could do something in their favor. And she said, I have no thinking on that because it's not my problem. I'm too poor to be worried about corruption. This is for the rich, for those who pay taxes. I don't pay taxes, so it's not my problem. And I think that illustrates that one of the problems of corruption is that victims are anonymous and they don't feel they are victims. So mobilize this huge amount of people is very difficult. So we need to put a message there that and put the human face of the consequences of corruption. Corruption kills. The other day in Argentina, there was a flood, and some people died. And the bishop of that town said, this is a direct consequence of corruption. So corruption floods, said the bishop. And it is true, corruption kills, corruption denies education, corruption affects health, and many other things. There's also something we're trying, Akaash mentioned already, the Cyberman Center in New York, and there are several pro bono networks of lawyers that are willing to do and to support some of these cases. So it is always interesting to try to partner with them. And of course, civil society organizations like Global Witness and others are taking cases directly to court.
Okay, thanks, Akaash.
I was getting very good with these questions because it's a long time I can find those. On the question of amendments, I can report and be honest, agree with José. The ICC is a stuff of high romance. If it didn't exist, those of us who believe in justice canceling borders would create it. The idea of the ultimate court of last resort that encapsulates universally shared values and tries to enforce universally shared rights. That is the dream of every person who believes that the law is the final legal force, is no less fine grit than power. The truth is, politics, as often said, is the art of the possible. And my sincere estimation is that if the Treaty of Rome were to come up for a vote today, we would stop and asking the countries of the world, do you want an international criminal court with no parts? I think that the challenge of the ICC today is to fight for what we have achieved. I do not think that in the foreseeable future we can stand in the court as much as I wish for otherwise. On the question of Afghanistan, I will add one other attention to this inclusive case of misperceptions, I think, we have about corruption around the world. There is a view that corruption, especially land corruption, is a problem of the developing world, and it's a problem of countries that are meaning here for people. The problem in Afghanistan is of a colossal level, and it is entirely enabled by actors in the developing world. I met with some of the generals who are in charge of NATO's program in Afghanistan during an optimized program where they were trying to win over the warlords. At one point, they told me they were shipping in so much cash to pay off the warlords that they couldn't count it. Instead, they had to put the cash on pallets and weigh it and try to get a sense of how much money was possible on a basis. You can imagine what that does to the rule of law, and I think that's what we're going to come to. But I think Afghanistan demonstrates the sense in which if we want to fight corruption in the developing world, we also have to fight it in the developed world and to recognize that it's everyone's problem. On the question of national instruments versus international instruments that simply raised, I don't think we should underestimate how powerful the use of existing laws can be, existing national laws. Money is slippery, and not that, but it also means it's everywhere. And one of the reasons why we are pursuing or looking at New York State is because the laws of New York State say that if you have illicit cash, $1 passes through a New York institution. The courts of New York have jurisdiction. And there are pluses and minuses of an integrated financial network. The minus is that it's hard to track cash and track funds around the world and the FBI. The plus, though, is that if you're a country and you've stolen $1 million, that $1 million is going to touch almost every jurisdiction on the planet. And we only need to find one of them that's friendly to us to go after. On the question from Christina, many questions, I would say the issue of should the attenuation of presumption of innocence decreasing the human rights of perpetrators emotionally, I respond to that emotionally because there's nothing that makes me love a little more than the sight of someone who has been abusing other people's human rights, claiming that attempts to bring them to justice on abuse of his human rights. The caution that I would offer is that I do worry about anti-corruption instruments being themselves corrupted. In other words, if there were an anti-corruption law which says you don't really need to prove that, I'm not saying this is what you're saying, but you don't really need to prove that a person has done anything, you just have to have suspicions. I can tell you that people who use those laws are not innocent people. It would be that trample regimes who would use such laws against the communities. Having said that, I do think that there are other ways of attacking. So, for example, in the UNCAT, there is a provision on unexplained work. Many countries have refused to enforce it because they've said it's a violation of domestic human rights. I disagree with that. The basic idea that unexplained work is if you have $1 billion or $100 million sitting in your account, you have a positive obligation to explain where that money came from. And if you can't give a reasonable explanation of how you received it legally, then therefore the courts can presume your debt. Not every jurisdiction, many jurisdictions take that view, no hold of them. And I would say that that is one case where I would agree with that provision of UNCAT, because ultimately you must know where your money came from. And if you can't explain it, it's not because you can't, it's because you know. And finally, on the question of the Arab world, it is one of the GOPAC's greatest strengths is that we work with parliamentarians from every political position. One of our greatest challenges is that we work with parliamentarians from every political position. That means that we draw our strength from our ability to bring people to the table who disagree with one another. And one of the rules to the GOPAC national chapter is that it must include and opposition parties. But that also means the necessity that we have equal ones at GOPAC who have the votes of these people who are disagreeing. But one of the things we have to remember is that we cannot win the war against corruption by ourselves. None of this is strong enough to do it or not. But instead of winning, I think the community will put put aside our differences and work together towards a common end. Sometimes that means working with people who you might find otherwise distasteful, but the consequences of not doing so I believe are worse than consequences.
Thanks very much. I'll just add to the end mark, which is probably a case of one step forward, two steps back. The speaker in the end mark is also a general part of the ruling elite in the top group there. He invited us in, we've established GOPAC parliamentarians under him, and thanks to being in the opposition, we're close with him, and of course last week, overnight, the rest of the military pulled him aside, took him out of the elite, and he's probably going to be voted out as speaker. We'll see. We can only wait to see what happens in the election, and in the end, people will make a stand in some way, we hope. Okay, let's go to another six. We start here.
As you see, things are happening, and I just read that the Guatemalan president has been indicted for corruption by the Guatemalan my name is Ana Ugaz, I'm a member of the European Parliament, and I want to request points I believe, and I agree with you, that the pushing for a change of the ICC at this moment would be a lost time. But I think indeed there is a case in making a case go through the ICC where indeed corruption is seen and assumed as an aggravating factor for human rights violations and humanity. So the question is, actually, using the ICC as it is now to make a case there, to build a case there. But then, at the same time, I think you need the support of transparency international experts to actually help individual countries to try not only their own blood, but corrupt another country that used the financial system for that country to actually run the money and to invest in the proceeds. But I think that a priority at this moment ought to be Ukraine. But we know the Ukrainians were to uncover all the way the proceeds of the Yanukovych autocracy were actually put in safe havens in the European banks, European policy. And it's quite outrageous that after having, for instance, called for sanctions in the middle of the Maidan, and I guess that helped to accelerate the development there, but nothing is happening. I believe we need political support, but technical support. From the into the Transparency International to make cases in European countries in which are the ones where the fortune stolen by the Yanukovych hypocrisy have been used. And of course, I'm also thinking, for instance, concerning Brazil and Angola. Portugal and Spain are instrumental in that system of transferring the money, shifting the profits, and then transferring it into other we absolutely could build cases in Portugal and Spain regarding these people from Brazil and probably the equatorial and so on. And but we need expertise, and by the way, that and I'm not just talking about officials or high officials, the presidents, banks, governors. I'm talking about public prosecutors who are totally and also going against lawyers, European lawyers, Portuguese, Spanish, who have been actively working for the attack.
Okay. One from the back.
My name is Trevor Monroe, and I'm head of the chapter in Jamaica, and I served for 10 years in the Jamaican Parliament for the Senate. My question is, to what extent the global organization of parliamentarians against corruption do a checklist or have some record as to how parliamentarians or members of the organization vote when the time comes to deal with anti-corruption legislation? Secondly, and conversely, to what extent can you incentivize parliamentarians who are in the organization to blow the whistle against other parliamentarians who may be in their same political party who are conspiring, collaborating with corruption?
Great points. Question front.
I'm Pierre, Prolinks with International Development Agency CEDA. I'm awfully happy to hear that we are now about to make the necessary and long overdue link between corruption and human rights violations and also crimes against humanity. In parentheses brackets, I would also say that we should change terminology. Petty corruption is also life for lots of people, but it doesn't fall under the same category. But it's not petty at all. Latest studies from Mozambique show that 10 to 20% of the poorest population cannot even afford the soft drink bribe, which means life or death literacy or illiteracy to them. So there's nothing petty about that. But anyhow, perpetrators of grand corruption, they are committing crimes against humanity. I'm very happy to hear that we're now about to make that linkage. But I'm rather unhappy about my question. Which is linked to when we peg this to the ICC. It shouldn't be an elephant in the room that there is a legitimacy problem, and that is linked to an efficiency problem with that international body. So if we want to see this as a package, the question would be, how do we link this dimension of what we would like to see as ICC mandates in practice or not, also to campaign to broaden the group of signatories to the Rome statutes? Thank you.
One other one in the front.
Hi, I'd like to ask a more general question. I'm an investigative journalist and photographer, cover a lot of different issues all over the world, and corruption comes to the forefront when I get into these stories. I'd like to ask the panel, what is it that you would suggest that you could use from people like me in the media or journalists, or what more can journalists do to help create awareness? I often feel there's a disconnect between the public and this room. One of the things that I've found useful is creating a storyline or translating an issue into a coherent way that the public can understand. If the public understood more about these issues, there might be a groundswell that would then lead to some kind of action. So I'd like to hear what their thoughts on that. Well, thank you.
One further in the front, in the lady in the back. You.
Hi, so this has been really interesting. I've just a few scattered comments. First thing is, Akaash, I want to say I really appreciated the way you laid out the four different prongs of the strategy that GOPAC is pursuing. And even again, talk about this is an each approach. I would like to see more of that in the way that people, including people in the activist community, think through these issues. That is very helpful in understanding ancestral strengths and weaknesses. My question relates to that actually relates to the transitional justice panel we had, which we also participated in. And the Guatemala model, the CSIG model, the kind of hybrid international domestic institution, the extent to which that might be a plausible fifth item in Akasha's list of institutional strategies one might use to address grand corruption for the appropriate justice. I'd be interested in what both, actually all three of you would have to say about that as a kind of hybrid institutional mechanism. The other observations I want to make quickly, I think it's great that all of your organizations, other people bring these cases. I do think, and I keep doing it, I do think sometimes, especially when we're talking about systemically corrupt countries, whereas a lot of people in the audience have made comments to, all the power for corruption. There's sometimes, I think, a bit of a tendency to see judicialization and courts domestically or internationally as a kind of deus ex machina that can somehow solve the problem without regime change. And I think that, again, without saying anything disparaging on the great work of so many people in so many cases, I do think collectively it's important for us to recognize the limits of judicialization and courts for dealing with thoroughly systemic corruption. Sometimes we really do need regime change. Once you do, you move into the transitional justice kinds of issues we talked about at yesterday's panel. But short of that, there's no way you're going to get a just the right lawsuit that's really going to put these people in jail. Getting their money away, putting them in jail, not so much. The other observation relates to a couple of changes with the audience. I do think there are really serious concerns about the ways how people are able to deploy their resources to resist being held to account. I start to get a little bit nervous when people start talking about things like relaxing usual human rights standards or treating this somehow intrinsically problematic these people hire lawyers. And if the lawyers are assisting them in perpetration of criminal acts, that's clearly bad. But you know, we normally have this idea that everyone deserves legal representation and we have human rights for criminal defendants for a reason, and the Flames Blackstone ratio is better, so that 10 million people go free than punishable innocent, and so on and so forth. And I don't know, this isn't really a coherent comment, but even though I'm with all of you and need to get ends, I start to get a little bit uncomfortable. Other people have these kinds of conversations where they talk about second terrorists or other people engaging in crime or doing bad. And you know, I need to be careful about this. But the point that I guess it relates to is once you create the mechanisms, the legal mechanisms, they're not just going to be used in easy cases of the obviously corrupt. We're always going to push the boundaries and bring cases at the boundaries. And as you're getting this point before, there's not necessarily always a guarantee that everybody we seek to punish is actually going to be the people we have in mind as our paradigm cases when we have this conversation. The last thing is a totally irrelevant, sorry, fancy point about Kasiako, which I love, except if he was a radical libertarian, we talk about Ugaz plunder, you know, things like public schools and progressive income taxation. So might not be the best, but in a way for going
after interpretation.
Exactly. Fair enough. But those are my
options. Thank you. Adam?
Sorry, Sarah Chase from Carnegie Endowment. I wanted to come back to the definition issue. And I'm not sure this is an entirely useful comment in this context. I understand the purposes within a judicialization of this issue of creating a separate category of grand corruption, but similarly to what we heard earlier about petty corruption not being petty, I think, and you referred to it, José, when in your initial remarks, we're talking about networks here. And the networks are both vertically and horizontally integrated in many, many of these cases. And so where there may be individuals who are network nodes who are perpetrating solely what might be called, in this context, grand corruption, it's useful, I think, as we all continue to consider this issue, to remember that not only are the acts of petty corruption not petty, because of the financial implications, but also the dignity and humility implications. But also they are usually wired in to the network. So very often the cops at the bottom of the pile are actually sending money up the chain. So that's an Afghanistan example where it's between $2 and $6 billion a year in so-called petty corruption, that's going up the chain. And so becomes one of the revenue streams that's captured by the grand corrupt. So again, I understand the need to separate them out for the purposes of prosecution, but it's useful for us all not to fool ourselves by that convention.
Okay. A couple last questions over here.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for the presentation. My name is Anga Tunisina, I'm from UNGP, and we also have a UNGC committee that I think that we also bring out prospective from UN. I'm a lawyer, I'm a development practitioner, and following what UN has said, anti-corruption movement for the past 15 years. And I would also like to congratulate José being very honest, in the sense that I moved to an agenda of our 2006 Guatemala IACC. And we have been talking about the same issues on, you know, again and again, grand corruption or petty or not, or how we do it, you know. But we are still struggling with this big issue, and I thank you for your leadership, at least putting again issue of grand corruption on the agenda. We'll get somewhere, you know, I'm really hopeful. But I again would like to bring this issue of defamation. And you were in our UNDP event, and we spent a lot of time, you know, going back again, how we define, you know, even normal corruption. I'm saying, I'm not even talking about grand corruption, because we have the instrument, the United Nations Convention Against Corruption. It really doesn't define, it gives some pieces here and there. Then we also, you know, conducted a study in UNDP from women's perspective, you know, the issue of physical harm, sextortion, and so on. Nowhere in the definition of grand corruption we see that aspect as well. So the moment we try to go into grand corruption, we have this tendency of going more towards money implication of definition of corruption. So my question is, how we deal, you know, in terms of global anti-corruption community, in defining what corruption really is? That's the first question. The second question is, even in the UN system, when we talk about global norms and standards, if we go to Human Rights Council, they look at issue of corruption from human rights perspective. And thank you for bringing the issue of how we, you know, channel resources back. And there has to be that marginalized, vulnerable, you know, aspect of population who should benefit from that money, this scholar money. But when you look at the UNCAC and we have Vienna, you know, like with our UNODC colleague, we tend more the asset recovery, money laundering, you know, the monetary aspect there. So we still need to do, even in the UN system, to bring this, you know, stream of all together, so that in the next, say, 5 years, we have one definition. You know, it doesn't matter whether it's from human rights or, you know, it's from anti-corruption. But I was probably listening, you know, 11 earlier, saying, explaining the wealth. But I was in Botswana. What happened is, when the DCEC seized property, you know, just saying that, you know, someone was alleged to be corrupt, the kids, you know, they had nothing to do with their parents. I had to drop from primary school, and it is the DCEC director telling me that story. See, there is human rights element there too. After all, those people are also human beings. They have family members, they have kids. So we can't, you know, violate the basic tenets of our democracy and, you know, the freedom, other freedom. So we are struggling, you know, even in UNDP and UNODC, how do we handle these two issues? So, question back to you, Dr. Okay, thank you.
Okay, gentlemen.
Yes, thank you. Well, I'm a member of the Kenyan National Assembly, member of parliament. Also, the chair of APNEC, it's an African Parliamentarian Against Corruption. I'm also the board of GOPAC, Audit Committee. That's me. However, my comments on this issue of corruption. We've been looking at it now for a couple of years. I think we looked at it in Panama and before. UNCAC has its own ideas. From where I sit, I think firstly I'd like to answer the senator, former senator. We would rather have 5 members of APNEC than 40, as long as we're all working. And we have a code of conduct and an ethics. If you have even the slightest hint of activity that is not in line, we do not accept you. That means either financial or personal. If you're found in a brothel, we're not going to accept you. That's answering to you. The Kenyan Parliament has made a few steps. We have 5 of us. There were 4, 5 or 7. There were 40 of us. But the 4, 5 or 7 make an impact. Every time there's a law, whether it's the leadership or ethics law, we're up there, we will say what we need to say. TI has been very supportive of us and gives us all the lobbying that we need. However, like for Kenya, the president of this our country, or whatever he is, they have suspended 5 cabinet secretaries, or 4 cabinet secretaries and 5 PSs. Now that we think is a positive step. So we want to accentuate the positive in Kenya. There may be so many things that we hear from TI as to the perception of Kenya and the perception of other places, but we'd like to put this issue into context. In the context, when we talk about the difference between corruption and what you say, petty corruption, we use the word corruption to survive. So, better that we take one person of bad corruption to rule back and have him executed. I mean, that's taking the extreme. Better we have the punishment very clearly done. And for the first time, we've had the president have suspended 3 or 4 cabinet ministries. Just like that. So we can see, the people can see that things are happening. And when the policeman wants to take a small bribe, this is the greatest instrument of anti-corruption that we have now. What it is that we've got people now starting to get aware because people are being actually prosecuted. The only reason people start becoming laxed and apathetic I hope it's nothing to do with the corruption and everything. But the apathy, we're talking about apathy. The moment we go back into apathy, we have a problem. Now in Kenya and in Malaysia, I'm very pleased to see that people are out demanding justice. And that's the only way we're going to do it, even in Africa. So I would like to plug the last point, is that we as parliamentarians, I mean, we know that some of us are worse than you are, but as Akaash says, we're going to work with all. And we were hoping and looking that in the Kenyan parliament, I guess people think, we would like to see how we are going to put at least the proposal of grand corruption, and we would like to work with GOPAC and of course the TI and others, so that we can put it in. It may be shot down, but we should put it in. We have friends. Our friends now are the speakers of the two the Senate and the National Assembly, and the President of the country, and the Leader of the Opposition. Now what else do you want? So that's why we're saying don't give up. Work with us. We are politicians, but some of us will do what you want to do. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I think we'll have Kenya and Tonga racing to see which can be the first national parliament to introduce legislation. Now, I'm going to call on the 3 speakers to respond. This may be your last chance to speak, given the time, and then I'm going to give from this arc final 3 comments, if not questions, from the audience. So I'll go from right to left this time. So, José, I'll come to you first.
Thank you. I'll try to be brief. We are absolutely conscious that the initial issue is a debate. It's impossible to capture in some places the complexity of the corruption phenomenon, but actually for instrumental purposes. That's the only reason. When TI put out the definition of corruption, abuse of public power for personal gain, of course that definition doesn't capture all the complexity of corruption, grand corruption, even corruption, whatever. But it had a virtue that is there, everybody talks about it, and put the issue of corruption in the agenda. And that is something that people could understand very easily. There are thousands of definitions of corruption, some more complex than others. But I think that for the purpose of campaigning, raising awareness of the people, definitions are useful. So we are happy that people have different opinions on definitions because this generates what we just are willing to generate. It's
its comments and debate and putting the issue on the agenda. So it is true, there are different approaches to the issue of corruption. What we are trying now, putting out a definition of grand corruption, is just to raise awareness that we are talking about a phenomenon that has significantly increased. Of course, the petty corruption or small corruption or day-to-day corruption has impacted human rights. There's no doubt. And we had a conversation with the deputy director of UNDP in Addis some weeks ago, and he was saying that the priority for them is that small corruption that is affecting the day-to-day lives of people. And it's true. But one doesn't exclude the other. So it's a matter of strategy, priorities, and how we are going to address the issue. The other thing, just for the sake of time, that I would like to mention is the one related to what you mentioned as judicialization of the corruption cases, and bringing cases to court and start talking about cases. Of course, TI is willing to be an actor in the court all the time, and Peter Iger, our founder, is always remaining being that we shouldn't engage too much in court cases and litigation, because our option has been always structural. And how can we generate change, and how can we influence in the decision makers in order to make sustainable changes that reduce corruption? And we, of course, are still in that track. But cases are also instrumental for a strategy in order to address corruption, in my opinion. First of all, cases serve justice. There are victims there that are expecting results and need to be repaired, and that's something we can, if we can help to do that, we are happy to do it. Secondly, if those cases are efficient, they could be a deterrent factor for people that are entering into public service or thinking of getting involved in corrupt practices. Thirdly, I think that cases bring visibility and have impact in the public opinion. We are talking about how do we engage with the public opinion. Public opinion usually gets engaged when you have a concrete case, a face, numbers, situations that have been linked to corruption. So again, as a definition, for us now, trying, and we will see what happens, this is just a trial, we're trying to engage Transparency International in some concrete specific cases is for that purpose, in order to draw attention, to make it visible to that impact, to for our other purposes to try structural change. And certainly I believe very, very strongly on what you said. We need to translate our language sometimes to one another here in this circle, but go out to the street that people is thinking absolutely the other way. In many countries like mine, corruption is normalized. So people assume that's a way like this, and it's the only way to move in the social scale. So we need to do something in order to target and impact on organizing.
Patrick. Thank you. The issue that Cedar raised about thinking good at the link between corruption and human rights abuses has been recognized. I'd just like to say that Global Witness was formed 20 years ago exactly to deal with this issue. And this issue of human rights abuses related to corruption is apparent in the way various people describe it, as corruption involves the health budget, the education budget, the infrastructure budget. But there are also much more dramatic ways that human rights abuses. The first campaign we ever did was sort of the timber trade between the Khmer Rouge and Thailand. And the shocking thing that we found was that the logging companies, Thai logging companies, paid $90 a cubic meter to the Khmer Rouge, whose territory the timber was in. And they paid $35 a cubic meter to the Cambodian government to award the certificate of origin that they lived to be exported to Thailand. They cooperated to raise money to fight each other. And that was our first realization of, my God, what we stumbled upon here. Charles Taylor's timber trade, between 1999 and 2003, he sold his timber to Chinese and European logging companies.
One of those is one of the largest global trades of timber, the DLH, a Danish company. We try, and this goes to this issue of taking people to court. We at that time had a campaign, trickle lending in the industry, and we wanted to take companies to court. We spent years trying to do it. We are still trying to do it with that one company. And it's very hard to find anyone to take on that jurisdiction. The company got us got free. But here we lost 250,000 a day. And when the diamonds were sanctioned, it was still the effect of that war. And in Liberia more recently, 25% of the country's land area was taken as a legal land grab led by a logging company in South Africa. Who we first came across in Cambodia, we did much the same thing. And just lastly on that particular issue, we also focus on the issue of environmental defenders, people who are defending perhaps their village, their forest, their farmland from land grab. And we're producing reports over the year now on many of these people who get killed. It's too cool. Trying to defend their land. And that land is undoubtedly being given to someone through a corrupt deal. Our journalist colleague, we certainly work very closely with investigative journalists and are always open to more partnerships, both through journalists who work for an existing media outlet. Because investigative journalists bring another aspect of the investigation, they have our own aspects, but investigative journalists hustle better than we do, I think. And also getting the story out there. So when we exposed the Oceania story in America, the money he had in Washington was done in collaboration with the consortium of Los Angeles Times. We actually hire now two investigative journalists full time. We're not saying we're working on campaigns per se, but in the long haul on particular stories. So I think that's, given the cut in budgets for investigative journalists, I think NGOs are increasingly going down that route. Going on to, you know, I talked about our frustration of trying to bring cases and not getting anywhere. What we do increasingly is tip off relevant law enforcement agencies. And not just tip off, we have relationships with them. Because although their wheels grind slowly, their sanctions grind slowly. And that I think is very worthwhile. It's frustrating sometimes as well. Again, you can't criticize people for hiring lawyers. And criticize a system that doesn't allow civil society to have as many works or as good. And I think you can have a reason to suspect and investigate someone if they are showing well their salary is not justified. The son of President Ugaz, director of the Indian Tax Service, do his job at his pay rate for 730 years to justify what he spent. Yeah, I think I'll stop on that point. I'm just about to give up.
Thanks, Akaash.
I
won't cover everything, I'll just touch on my colleagues. On the question of so called, first of all, welcome journalists to create awareness. I think there are two aspects. The first is the quote corruption, which is given the terms that people have come to this out. We estimate that corruption annually goes to 140,000 billion by private and public who work in medical care. And that is much more meaningful than the opposite of $6 billion that had disappeared. Still more than examples are images. Images have the ability to motivate and move people in a way that politics simply cannot. And I think that global revulsion towards the end of COVID hit a fever pitch when there were images of his zoo, his galleon, and his match, that made people understand this person wasn't just stealing, he was involved in a grotesque and vulgar excess that could only be explained by tyrannical powers. On the question of the judicialization of corruption, I agree entirely. I think we often look to the courts as a metaphor for right and wrong. The courts are just another public institution and they are just as susceptible virtuous or corrupt. But I do think that courts are an important venue. We know in GOPAC that we can't get all the autocrats. We just want to get enough of them that we will put a chill down the spine of all their fellow travelers. And the prospect of being caught will restrain some other autocrats. The knowledge that some of them didn't get away with it will energize civil society and might help shape people's sense that nothing can be done.
On the question of sometimes you have to shift, it's sometimes it's not just working system, sometimes the entire system is corrupt. I agree. I think when the law becomes the enemy of justice, it is not merely the right, it is the responsibility of citizens to pull down the entire political process and so on. And I don't think there's anyone who would disagree with that. On the question of so-called petty corruption, I try never to use the term petty corruption. I try to make a distinction between high corruption and broad corruption, because this part of the continuum. And the reality that most people face is the reality of day-to-day extortion and day-to-day oppression of smaller level corruption. Having said that, we do believe that there is still a special reason to go after grand corruption, and that is because, firstly, grand corruption does not exist in a vacuum. It sits at the apex of an entirely broken system. You can't be effective at that in an honest country. And therefore, attacking autocracy is a good way of describing the snake in the head. Moreover, grand corruption isn't just broad corruption writ large. It isn't just one who runs you for $1 billion. It is different not just in scale, but in time. And the worst part about grand corruption isn't that people are making more money than they will ever be able to spend in their entire lifetime. And it's not even that grand corruption means that you're depriving the public resources of vast amounts of money. It is that to engage in grand corruption, you have to pervert the state itself. You have to make the state, which belongs to the people, the enemy of the people. You have to make the law, which is the assertion of justice, the enemy of justice. And it is only by attacking that calls for special measures. And finally, on the question of the definition of grand corruption, I'm reminded of the remark made by the Supreme Court in the United States. I can't define pornography, but I know when I see it. When we go after people who commit grand corruption, we're not aiming to go after everyone. We're not aiming to go after people on the margins. We're going to aim to go after people where there will be no doubt that they are engaging in autocracy, because we think that if we can only get a few people, we want to get the worst offenders. And I believe that it is possible for a viable definition of grand corruption to evolve through common law practice. There is no statutory definition of murder in the United Kingdom. There's a common law definition of murder, which is evolved over time, the killing of one person by another. And similarly, I think as we go after that, we will build up a body of law and body of understanding that will give a stronger definition as time goes on. I think it would be a mistake for us to try and come up with a perfect definition of grand corruption. What we want is a workable definition of grand corruption. And I define a workable one as a definition that allows us to get the absolute worst offenders and make the rest of them run for things.
Thanks, Akaash. Final two comments from the audience over this side. These two here. Thanks. Okay. Yeah, and a final,
oh,
sure, okay. Sir?
My name is Lord Stewart. I'm a Lord's member of Parliament in Song, and I'm the chairman of our anti-corruption standing committee in Parliament, and the chairman of that chapter. My question is primarily to Akaash, but feel free to share your experience with me. But my question is to do with the involvement of parliamentarians. As a legislator in the judicial process of bringing other parliamentarians to justice. We're currently undergoing the ministerial pensions in Tonga, and I'm chairing the privileges committee that's left. So I'm here that the impeachment case will go ahead. It's for nepotism, for awarded contracts, particularly as the awarded contracts in Tonga, and for maladministration. Now, under our constitution, once an impeachment case goes ahead, the eventual determination of guilt or otherwise ends up being by ballot. So I've been curious about your experience when bringing on the grand or petty corruption to justice, the efficacy of the involvement of other legislations in the eventual determination of guilt that would be extremely.
Thank you. Number two, in front of you,
three. Thank you. Miguel Domingo from VIA, the Public Foundation from Spain. I think the question of the definition is more important than it looks.
If we arrive at a definition that is workable, we could propose to different countries to use it in as a common phenotype in their criminal codes. And these, if it were accompanied by the fact that those countries agreed upon a similar thing to the European Common Warrant of Arrest, it would be extremely useful. And I will end by recalling that this was a proposal of our government in Spain, and completely against what everybody thought, it took less than 6 months for the whole European Union to accept it.
Okay, good comment. Final comment from a most patient audience member.
Not sure about that. My name is Frank Vogel with the Partnership for Transparency Fund, which is obviously. To your attention. The very first book that the PTI ever published was called Grand Corruption, 1994. It was about corporate paper payments. 22 of the 41 OECD anti-bribery convention signatories have not prosecuted or investigated a single case. Only 4 of the 41 have significantly enforced the convention in the last 4 years. I would like to encourage parliamentarians for you in the OECD countries, be very focused on the large forest, to actually start doing something about this. Their silence is deafening. Corporations, which are also partly involved in grand corruption, are getting away with it. And I think the parliamentarians really should feel guilty about the complete inactivity of this time. Finally, I hope you have a chance, someone, to answer the question of my colleague did answer, and which you will avoid. Thank you.
Okay, I will let Akaash and some I can probably say with GOPAC, our former chair from the Philippines, the moment there was an allegation of corruption against him, Senator Angara, he stepped down and pressure was on him to step down. Now, he has never been charged, he has never been convicted or anything, but under the code of conduct, as our Kenyan MP mentioned, if there's an allegation, you should step down. I'll let Akaash have a couple of one final comment to wrap up there. And if people have other comments or want to talk to us, please do. Akaash.
I didn't avoid this question. I felt that it had been addressed by Shaquille from Kenya. From the 2 points that Trevor raised, first, do we keep a record of all the comments of our upfront returns? No, we don't. I think that's a very interesting idea. I will take it back to my colleagues. We don't want to go to that, but some of our regional chapters might. On the question of what can we do to incentivize parliamentarians, I think this also goes to the real question about what we do to incentivize parliamentarians to act against corruption by their colleagues. That is a huge question, because one of the greatest enemies of parliamentarians doing their job to be the guardians of the public trust is party discipline, party loyalty, and the knowledge that if you turn on someone within your own party, irrespective of the merits of it, you may suffer for it. There's a limit to what we can do as an international organization, but one of the things that we can do is valorize those people. We can lift this talk of people who do their jobs at great personal peril, ensure that the world knows about it, and hopefully that their constituents will. For example, we have recently signed up our first international anti-corruption parliamentarians, and it's gone to a parliamentarian from Yemen, who I must tell you is now one of his colleagues, has had to take flight from the parliament of Yemen. And on the question of impeachment proceedings, we want to talk about that afterwards. It's a very complex subject that's built into it. I'll tell you, as he did basically impeachment proceedings in his own house. But I'll say in previous terms, the first case is always the hardest case. Almost always going up that far, instruments to help take the process out of Parliament, even though it's under the supervision of Parliament, so that there isn't a conflict of interest, so that the process doesn't become politicized.
Okay,
Okay, thank you very much. I'd like to thank José, Akaash, and all our audience members for being part of this. Thanks a lot. And the members of the Parliament, GOPAC members, and former members, to stay for a quick photo. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Okay.
所以呢，我们去可能大型也就不用去，就拿小的地方去一两天，一天去拿温泉酒店，一天去扫地。
Justice and Saeed from your office is trying to sort of put us in touch, and
he sent